So most people would be familiar with IIT Madras as a top engineering college. However, coming from a different perspective, this campus is home to over 190 species of birds, 75 species of butterflies, 25 species of dragonflies, 10 species of mammals, amongst the rest yet to be identified and others yet to be documented. Today, I will be taking you on a small walk through the species seen in one of the locations, most popular locations for nature walks on campus, the Manohar Srivatsa Stadium. The stadium marked as a red circle on the map is approximately 2 kilometers from the Adyar entrance of the campus. The location is easily locatable for visitors. If they were to come straight down from the gate, they should find it, find the location on their left. Once entering the stadium, regardless of the time of the year, one would typically find yourself looking at this view. Facing forward, a short bridge leading into the ground with the path being surrounded with cassia, banyan trees on the right, and these ornamental plants. So before we head into the stadium, we will first take a look at some of the creatures we can find here. So this ornamental plant is one of the host plants for the Indian palm bob butterfly. The butterfly, as indicated on the right, and this is the life cycle of the Indian palm bob, starting off with this egg, which is less than 0.5 mm in radius. The caterpillar, once it emerges, undergoes 5 instars before pupating. So this is the first instar and the last instar. The other three I don't have covered here. So when the caterpillar is feeding, it also creates a small shade for itself by cutting and folding the leaf. Under the same palm is the nest of these paper wasps. Many of you may have seen similar paper wasps building nests in your houses and especially on window sills. As an interesting fact, these paper wasps have been found to be able to remember and identify each other. Also on these plants is several different types of spiders, and as a representative, here is the whiteling spider, which is approximately 1.5 centimeters in length. Moving on to the cassia trees on the side of the path, we find a wide variety of birds on the trees, including wide-billed bulbuls, greater caucals, and Asian quails. If you're here during certain times of the day, you may come across mixed species foraging party, aka bird wave. Also on these trees are the host plant for mottled and common emigrants. The early stages of these butterflies can be quite challenging to spot, in particular the chrysalis which, or the pupa which resembles a green leaf. So moving on to the side of the path, looking below the cassia and on the right below the banyan, you would find a wide variety of species such as the Indian grey mongoose, rat snakes, chital, occasionally a boar, to mention a few. Also in the vicinity is a tree trunk which contains the nests for these greater banded hornets. These nests contain at least 60 individuals from my observations over the short period. So now I'll be showing you a video. These hornets typically raid several wasp nests and feed on their larvae. And paper wasps are extensively predated by these hornets. During the period that I monitored this nest, there have been several incidents where individuals have killed individuals belonging to the same species, and as a result, right outside the nest lay close to 25 to 30 dead hornets. In this video, one of these individuals manages to get away just in time. Should you find yourself here between the months of October to March or April, you would probably be able to find this rather shy bird. This is the orange-headed ground thrush, which has very melodious vocalizations. You may also be able to see the Indian pitta around this same place at the same time. Now moving into the stadium, keep your eyes as you eyes open as you cross this bridge. On the trees on the left, you can regularly see sunbirds. During certain times of the year, you may also see an oriole. During the monsoon, the water level below this bridge increases significantly, and you may be able to see fish and occasionally a snake or two in the water. Several migratory birds frequent this region, and some of the birds that you can see, which are not very common in many other places in Chennai, are the chestnut-winged cuckoos and the fairly common blue-throated flycatcher. During summer, as the water level recedes, the Crotalaria plants start growing, and at that time, you will be able to see quite a lot of blue tigers, plain tigers, and common crows nectaring on them. And should there remain a small amount of water, the location is frequented by bitterns, egrets, and striated heron in summer. Now, once you enter the stadium, you will find yourself facing this view. Moving left this way, you may find a wide variety of insects, amphibians, an occasional snake, and butterflies and moths during various times of the year. And should you move straight into the ground, you may come across red-wattled lapwings, large-bellied wagtails, and black buck. During June to September, you may also stumble upon large congregations of mud-puddling butterflies, especially the common immigrant, as Vikas had mentioned. And from October to March, you may see large numbers of citrine wagtails and yellow wagtails on the grass. Moving to the right, behind the shed, you'll initially find yourself in this shady spot. In the shade of the tamarind tree. The spot has quite a lot of snails and gastropods, and is again frequented by several migratory birds, amphibians, and tussock moth caterpillars. And as you move behind the shed, you will come across a lot of pongamia trees and false ashoka trees. During June to August, you will find a lot of spotswortels on the false ashoka trees, and throughout the year, you will see quite a few Indian sunbeam butterflies on the pongamia trees. So now I will basically show you some of the photos of these creatures. Also, in this photo below here is a chittal and a black buck under the gulmohar when it was flowering early this year. This plant is the host plant for the blue-striped nettle grub. And there are around 3 to 4 of these plants distributed around the stadium. The caterpillar of this moth, the blue-striped nettle grub, has a rather gentle appearance from afar. But actually, it has quite a lot of these needles which may poke you. So in case you get stung by it, it typically takes a day and a half to completely heal. And the caterpillars are quite well camouflage, so I would recommend checking before you put your hand into any of these plants. The clammy cherry plant, which locally I think most people know it as the Mukachali Param, is a plant that is present in several locations around the ground. So it is frequented by grasshoppers, lime swallowtail caterpillars, and lime blues. In this slide, the photos on this slide is a plant that contains hundreds of the grasshoppers in the nymphal stage. So now here's a snake, a rather common but heavily camouflaged snake, which resembles a vine. It typically is seen in higher canopies and goes unnoticed. So then this, which is commonly known as the flatworm or the hammerhead worm. These planarians emerge from the ground after rains. So they actively feed on mollusks and earthworms and are considered invasive in many places. There are two very commonly seen gastropods in the ground, of which the snail occurs extensively in many places. Especially under tamarind trees, you may see them in tens. So, then this is a species that I think many of us would have seen and wondered why they're joined together like this. So, this is the Indian red bug, which is seen throughout the country and is very common. And here is another individual which is emerging from its exoskeleton and possibly of the same species, but I'm not sure since the markings are incomplete. So now, as mentioned earlier, the campus hosts 190 species of birds, of which I will be running through some of the common species, starting with one which is a favorite for many people, the Indian paradise flycatcher. So all three individuals shown here are all males. At first sight, some of you might be thinking that this is a female, but actually, because it does not have a gray throat and has a very distinct blue color eye ring, it is a male. So next is the black rump flameback, which is again a very popular common bird. This is also a winter migrant, so you will not see it before October and after March. So this is a black rump flameback, which is a very common resident species. And so you can see it very commonly in the stadium, and actually in many parts of the city, there are people who observe them feeding on rice that is put out for crows. The little cormorant is commonly seen from the stadium near the water body. So once they are done fishing, they sit out like this to dry their wings in the sun. So also, one of the species that I think many of us will be familiar with is the rufous tripe, because it is a very vocal bird. So I will be playing two of its very common calls. Some of you may need to reduce the volume of your system a little bit, otherwise it might be very loud. So this is, that was one of its calls, and this is the, yeah. This is the call that most of us would be more familiar with. So next, moving on to the coppersmith barbit, it derives its name from its call, which supposedly sounds like the hammer hitting the metal when a coppersmith is at work. I hope you can hear it.
We can't hear the call.
Oh, okay. Okay. Oh, were you able to hear the tripe though?
No.
Okay, one second. Sorry.
Can you hear it now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so this is one of the TriPi's calls, and this is the second call that many of us would be more familiar with. So now I'll play the Coppersmith's call, which supposedly sounds like the hammer hitting the metal. So also it may be observed that this bird, when you hear the call, actually does not open its beak. But however, the calls are actually vocal. So next is the black kites. Okay, one second.
Can you still hear me?
Yes, Mahati.
Okay. So a couple of times of the year, one sees these black kites congregated on the grass, busy feeding. So apparently, this is because they supplement their diets using winged termites, or actually what we know as easel. So they feed on that, on the grass. So next is the yellow-billed babblers. Again, I have a video. They are known as the Seven Sisters because they basically are typically seen in groups of seven. So this video basically shows the yellow-billed babbler feeding on. Okay, I can't show the pointer. So the yellow-billed babbler is feeding on a moth caterpillar, which most likely belongs to the genus Amata. Okay, so now I have one more video of the citrine wagtail. This is the last video on the presentation. So this is the citrine wagtail, the individual in focus. The individual which is out of focus is the yellow wagtail. So these birds are typically seen on the grass between October to March. So here is a video of it for no specific reason. I suppose you can't hear its call either.
No, Madhi.
Okay.
Okay, so that is its call.
Yeah.
Moving on, this is the Oriental garden lizard. So they're very commonly seen and have quite a high abundance around the stadium. And in fact, actually, most likely throughout Chennai and many other parts of the country, they're very common. So all three individuals shown here are males. These two are in their breeding plumage, and their plumage, their coloration typically varies quite a lot from individual to individual and during different times of the year. So another very common reptile we have here is the bark gecko. So you may have to look at the slide a second time to be able to locate all three individuals. They are very impressive for their camouflage, and as a matter of fact, actually many houses also seem to have at least a couple of individuals of bark geckos amongst the common house lizard. So then here is the Indian black buck, which is a very popular species, especially in the light of stray dog attacks on campus. And I think it gets a lot of media coverage. So the individual you see here is an albino deer, and this is the female. So the dark colored individual is the male, and the light brown individuals are females. The smaller individual on the photo on the right bottom corner is a young individual, and typically one cannot determine the gender of the specimen until it grows older. So, by color, I mean. So then we also have a very good population of beetles on campus, and here are two of them. This is the yellow ladybug beetle, and this is a harder beetle. Both of them are quite commonly seen on campus. And as a matter of fact, they are actually pests, as Supraja had mentioned earlier. Then these are plant hoppers. Plant hoppers are quite commonly seen on campus and in many other places. They are very well camouflaged. So this is one of the most colorful plant hoppers that I know of, and it's also quite commonly seen, especially after rains. Then here are the jewel bugs. So I think many of us would have seen jewel bugs and been astounded by the colors, especially when we are younger. So we have quite large populations of jewel bugs, and I'm not completely sure of which species each one of them is. And I believe that we have at least 2 to 3 species on campus. So then here are two of the very commonly seen mantises in the ground. As a matter of fact, actually, they don't fall under the family Mantidae. And as I had mentioned earlier, we have nearly 25 species of dragonflies and damselflies. And these are 6 of the very commonly seen dragonflies and damselflies. Butterflies, again, as I had mentioned earlier, we have nearly 75 species of butterflies that have been recorded so far on campus. Here are 12 that I've shown here. So on this slide are 6. So some of the things to note is you might see the lime swallowtail here. For those of you who have seen lime swallowtails in the past, you might feel that the color is a little off. So this is basically because of the gulmohar pollen that has collected on the specimen. So then this is the little tiger pirot, or the Balkans pirot. So this was the first record for Chennai from stadium. And apart from that, here is the common emigrant mud puddling. As Vikas had mentioned earlier, they basically congregate on dam patches to basically absorb minerals and water from the ground. And here are 2 lime blues which are mating. We also have quite an extensive list of amphibians. Here are some 5 frogs and 1 toad. This one still remains unidentified, but as you can see, these are 4 of the very commonly seen frogs we have on campus, and a very commonly seen toad. One can typically see this common toad under the or rocks many times. As in, I mean, loosely packed, especially during the rain. So we also have a lot of fungi, which I have not been able to identify all yet. Here are just six of them. So apart from these, we have fungi which occur in many other colors as well, green and green, red, and many other colors. And these are definitely something that someone should take up and try to study to further detail. Okay, and thank you everyone for joining today. So as I finish, this is the chalky percha on a mushroom in the stadium. Thank you.